Hi, and welcome to Telepathic TV. This is television that you watch with your third eye. I'm R. Neville Johnston.
And I'm Mary Phelan, and our program is about raising our consciousness. And tonight's topic is going to be, what is standing in your way?
Mm-hmm. Okay. And we would be amazed by the colossus of things that would appear to be in the category of standing in the way, one of which is the very calendar we follow was originally designed to create the suppression of people that followed the calendar. It was a calendar imposed upon conquered people. And it's no irony at all that the Gregorian calendar is the calendar used here in the United States. So we are taking a great length to introduce what is a true calendar, the Mayan calendar. And today in Mayan is?
It's for can, and can is the word for seed in Mayan. And so today is a really good day to take power in your life about what seeds you're planting and what things you would like to have growing in your life.
Yeah.
The thing is the media definitely hypnotizes us, brainwashes us often with the hypnosis that goes on in our advertising and tells us to plant seeds that grow in our life. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, you know, just moving on to the topic of the show about what's standing in your way, you know, like growing the seeds in our life, we get planted in us that we have all these roadblocks, that these things going on in our life are you know, permanent fixtures. Like people say, oh, you know, I've got a barrier to being successful because I'm not beautiful, or I don't, you know, have this certain look or something like that. And then we allow that to become a roadblock that prevents us from getting where we want to go.
Well, the media sows seeds of death, mm-hmm. literally. Any of the things that we're encouraged to follow do result in death. Mm-hmm. By death, I mean death. Mm-hmm. And all of the pills being advertised constantly to cure, and we have to say cure, because you're not regulating it yourself. When you're regulating it yourself, then you can use the word cure. So these things that are designed to abrogate symptoms rather than identify and correct the source of whatever it is that's going on.
Well, you know, I was going to write this down the other day, you know, talking about that very topic, and I know I spoke to you about it. We're so busy treating our symptoms of things. And it's okay to treat the symptom, but just don't forget about looking for the cause.
Absolutely.
Because if you don't look for the cause, then you're gonna just be putting small fires out. There's a lot of, you know, talk about how many cases of cancer and other, you know, conditions, even psychiatric conditions. And what we really could be looking for is, why is it that there are so many of these cases?
But well, the language codes book would suggest, and if you wish to look like a screaming genius in front of your office, in front of your peer group, in front of your family, get in the habit of replacing the word problem with the word symptom, and you will automatically begin to focus in on the source of what's happening.
Oh, that's very
powerful. Whereas
the
problem is about, when you're using the word problem, you're already 50, 60 concentric rings away from what's actually going on.
Also, when you use the word problem, you reach a dead end. You mm-hmm. reach a, you know, just a dead end street.
You have to.
Oh, it's a problem. Okay,
yeah,
well, now let's look for somebody to blame for this problem. Whereas mm-hmm. if you say symptom, and I actually use that in the workplace
very well
a lot.
Done.
Instead of saying, oh, I've got a problem, I would say I've got a symptom. And then you ask yourself, a symptom of what? And then it's like, huh, a symptom of, you know, instead of I've got a problem getting purchasing to give me the paperwork mm-hmm. that I require. If you say the symptom, and then the symptom is what? Well, maybe purchasing doesn't have enough people to get the paperwork out on time. You can see how looking at it that way actually solves it and moves it forward.
Yeah.
But we are so hung up on looking at what is standing in our way in our life. Our attention is placed there constantly in the media. We're shown what's wrong, what's sick, how it is that we're powerless, how it is that we must rely on pharmaceuticals, and how we must rely on things outside of us. It's just all the time. It's just inundated with it.
All human beings come with 100% of the faculty necessary to create the evolution they've agreed to in a particular lifetime. And there's nobody dealing with anything that is not germane to their evolution. Mm-hmm. Therefore, everybody has 100% of the marbles required to play the game here. The word problem itself is something standing in the way, because the word problem obdurates, it changes it all to stone. Mm-hmm. Whereas symptom begins the analysis, problem stops the analysis.
Exactly.
That's, so that's one of the things standing in your way is the vocabulary. Our program is about, you know, what's standing in your way, what's keeping you from your next step forward. And a lot of it is the words we think in, which is totally invisible. You know, we don't recognize.
Until you see it.
Yes,
then
until
it's not
you
very
see
invisible.
It. Well, then it becomes steadily more visible. The longer you are alive, actually figuring out what effect a word has on the quantum field when you speak it or think it, mm-hmm. that's the essence of the language codes. What does the word do to the potential of you?
I would like to, you know, just congratulate you, because your first book, which came out in 99 or 2000,
it's still in print.
Was really groundbreaking. I know a lot of people are using that are conscious of the effects of language now, and mm-hmm. your book really was groundbreaking in that area for its time.
Mm-hmm.
So that's definitely true. One thing that I would like to suggest people to do, because if you look at your life, I think everybody out there can say, well, I have, you know, I'm very happy in, as far as this goes, but I feel very blocked with this, either getting that promotion at work or doing something creative or being happy. I would suggest that you take the time to actually write down all the areas that you feel blocked in your life, and then write down, and then take a piece of paper with each one of those and write what is blocking you. Because anything that is blocking you is an area where you're believing in your powerlessness. And mm-hmm. if you can identify the program that's making you feel blocked, you can really remove all this. And you know, we were talking prior to the show, another thing to do is to look at what your bottom line is. What reward are you getting by staying where you're at? And I know we've mentioned guilt is a big thing that keeps you stuck behind that block. That guilt, like, oh, I'm not entitled to move past this block, or I might be happy, and then, oh, we can't have that. We're not allowed to be happy. Then everybody will be jealous, or, you know, there's lots of different reasons. And knowing them really helps.
Another game you can play with yourself is to ask yourself, what is another word for block? What's another word for block? Come on, what's another word for block? Delay, all right, fine. Okay.
I see it as a
game.
Yeah.
As something you created to keep yourself interested enough to remain incarnate long enough to get the evolution accomplished that you agreed to get accomplished. Mm-hmm. So we have put all these stumbling blocks on our path in order that we find ourselves incentivized.
Challenged or?
Well, yeah, but the incentive to remain incarnate is very often the source of this. I, at one point, when superstition was still trickling through the thought process, that if I had actually solved all of my blocks, I would no longer be incarnate, which still makes sense to me, and still feel that there are other things I came here to get, absolutely, and feel that in 1,000 years I will have done a reasonable job and probably hang around for yet another 1,000 years.
That's a very interesting thing, because I think we are taught through our religion that mm-hmm. that we are that we're here to do something, and that, you know, if we still have things to do, then God won't take us, and things like that.
Superstitious thinking.
I think even beyond superstitious thinking, I think it goes along, well, could be the same thing. It goes along with this concept that we have to be earning our keep here all the time.
Uh-huh.
And I remember the day that I recognized that. I was meditating with the Two of Cups, and I got that more can be shared in one cup of joy than in all the rivers of sadness. And that was very profound for me, because in my deep subconscious mind, I really thought we had to have hard things. We had to have challenges to overcome, that was how we learned, and that was how we found love. And that love would be at the end of that, love and approval from some large being. I never really articulated that to myself, but I really see that's in the society's deep subconscious mind. Mm-hmm. And when I looked at it differently and I realized, wow, you know, I can share and learn so much more out of having a joyful experience and have much more to communicate to somebody, that I didn't have to wait till those depressed times to be creative, that I could be creative through joy. And that I think is a huge shift in the way you see reality.
Well, it is a very important point. As we were saying before, that what is the motivation for not dissolving the blocks in our way? What is the mm-hmm. motivation? And very often that will be that I will change. We have played so many games with so many people. There, one of the games is, what would you do as soon as you won the lottery? What would the first 10 things be that you do if you won the lottery? And that person will be naming the top 10 reasons that they do not win the lottery.
Mm-hmm.
That will be the reason.
Yeah. And if you say what changes in your life and really look at what would change in your life, that's what's scaring you.
It's a very deep psych, yeah. So what is it that you would do if you, who would you be if you undid whatever is standing in your way? Someone you're not prepared to be, or you would be doing that.
You remember we had a caller one time, a number of years ago, who she said that she was looking to get this promotion at work.
Mm-hmm.
And she couldn't figure out why it kept being blocked from her. She was qualified, blah, blah, blah. And she realized that, am I supposed to be looking over here? This is on. She realized I think we asked her, well, what would change about your life?
Exactly.
And she said, well, I would be working 50 hours a week instead of 40. I would have a lot more responsibility. And then halfway through it, she even caught on and she said, oh, that's why I'm not getting the promotion.
Yeah, you don't want it.
If you look at what's standing in your way and say, hey, you know, really look at how life would change, that's profound.
Yeah. So let's have some calls in if anyone would be interested in asking us questions of any sort, really. We seem to be always translating dreams for people. That's another thing that we provide on this show, is your look into you, especially if it's a dream that appears to be blocking you in one way or another. This is an important thing. But I'm sure the number is on the screen or will shortly be on the screen.
Well, and I'd like to, feel free to call in about a dream, but I'd like people to call in also about
questions.
Where they have blocks in their life.
Because tell
this
us about
is
that.
This is really a big issue. As a matter of fact, the work I do with people, the spiritual life coaching type things I do with people,
uh-huh.
really is about what their blocks are in their life and pinpointing them.
Yes.
And also our society, our culture, and just a lot of things teaches us to focus on the block and not the remedy. And I've said this a lot of times, you know, in karate you're taught to aim for an inch past the board.
Past the board,
so
yeah.
that your momentum is mm-hmm. going through the board, your greatest momentum, rather than if you aim at the board, you'll break your hand instead of the board. Well, whenever I do anything that I want to get past, like being afraid to go to the dentist or whatever that might be, I will project past the point of that and I will visualize the ride home.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we must do that with our blocks too. It's like, well, what's on the other side of my block that I'm afraid of to have in my life? Is it the having to work extra hours? Is that why the promotion's not coming? If you really focus on what you're pulling to you, the blocks will be revealed.
Mm-hmm. So, in becoming the person who can understand themselves, as always, the theme on this show is to become the more conscious person. And we'd like to say congratulations, human race, we the human race, on the amount of progress we've made. If any of us were to look at who we were in the mid-80s, big hair, shoulder pads, and that's the guys, not to mention the women, but the place where we were in the late 70s, you know, which was, oh, damn, I'm out of stash. No, wait, there must be more than this. You know, the amount of progress the human race has made in the last 3 decades,
mm-hmm.
And that we are so far more conscious of everything. I'm about to be doing the Galactic History lesson, and the galactic history lesson always starts out with, how many stars can you see? Call it an octillion. Okay, so the odds are an octillion to one that we are the only sapient life in the universe. Of course there's other civilizations. Of course. And that there's something the matter with someone if they don't recognize that there are other civilizations in the universe. Nothing the matter with us. Something the matter with people that are telling us that we're here alone, all this other stuff. It's just the byproduct of the slave mentality they keep selling us. We have cousins. There's a human civilization within 5 light years of us. Think they don't know? Of course people know.
Well,
of course.
You know,
but that's another, that's the this weekend, I believe.
Yes, Saturday at 4.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. If anybody's interested, they can contact us through the usual bat phone and on this bat channel.
Yes, it flies it around mm-hmm. the room. And
or the bat email now.
Hangs upside down right above the desk. Mm-hmm. And there's all that phone guano all over everything.
But you're right. You know, we are getting better and better all the time.
Yeah.
When I was a kid, I read Revelations in the Bible for a period of time when I was a teenager and in my early 20s. And, you know, this whole idea of, end of the world stuff. And I had a little bit of angst about it, to be honest, at the time. And mm-hmm. I through dreams and just revelation of my own, I got from early on that everything always will get better. That just, why even worry about it? You know, things always do improve. That's the nature of things, is to grow. It really is. That's mm-hmm. the true nature. And, you know, if it's looking like it's not growing and improving, it's because we are not looking at it clearly. We are looking at it with glasses that will seek anything that hasn't changed yet. If you look at our society and our culture and how we used to treat each other and how it has gotten vastly better, if we keep hanging on to the past about how we treated each other, I'm not saying remembering so that we grow. I'm not saying anything like that. But we have to get our consciousness catch up with the actuality. There's more love in the world every single day, and we've got to focus on that in order to let it train our eyes to be able to pick it out in a lineup.
In seeing the concept of blocks through the illusion, through the duality, then they are insurmountable. But if you'll say this, if you wish to say this, well, go on, say it. All my blocks are lollipops, and certainly I can lick them. And to start to see clean through the block, because it's really only a game you agreed to play, while
so
you
all
were
your
here.
Blocks are suckers.
Someone around there is a sucker for sure. But to start to see through the illusion is the purpose of our program. To see through
That's
the
good.
Duality.
I like that.
And then once you recognize this is something certainly that you will defeat, will it be defeated within 10 years? Will it be defeated within 5 years? And pick a calendar date and get to the point where you're through with it. But I believe we have our first caller already.
Okay, can I just say one
sure.
quick thing about the mm-hmm. blocks? I really do see that all human beings seek love, like plants' roots will seek water. And if it hits a stone or a block, it will do anything. It will grow in any direction to get down there to the water. Mm-hmm. And we are like that too. We will always seek and find love. Okay, our caller.
Hi, caller. What's your name, please?
Good evening, Mary and Neville. This is Tricia. How are you?
Hi,
good.
It's good to hear from you.
Well, I was so excited about calling in tonight because something happened this week that really, I guess, is an unblock for a good friend of mine who's been a lifelong atheist in his 50s, and his mother crossed over, and he was present when it happened, and he said that he saw her spirit leave her body, and it was kind of like a fog. And now he's like had this breakthrough. And I really wanted you to share your thoughts about this. And
okay.
I'd like to hang up so I could listen to what you're saying, please.
Okay, thanks.
Because of the lifelong resistance to what is very apparent very often to...
Apparent, yes. It was his mom.
Yes?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Because of the lifelong resistance, he is possibly beginning at square one, although he doesn't have to, and as little as I would believe in square one, but that he suddenly had his belief system collapse, and because he has resisted the idea of religion for so long, there is the possibility that he will shortly be born again, and then into the prejudice that that involves, and then eventually...
He died or his mom died?
Mom died. Okay. So that he was suddenly, through his own eyes, able to see that his belief system does not work. A person who has resisted something for so long, belief in any sort of anything, may fall into a relatively low place in this superstition of religion.
Mm-hmm. Well,
so we would recommend highly that he would watch the show, and we would recommend highly that he recognize himself as the creative force in the universe, because that's who we humans are. We are the creative force. We're it. I mean, you know, look at anything we do. We are a creative force. There are more than one, I acknowledge. But we are limitless creators.
Now
and he is in such danger of falling into superstition, as far as I can see, because of his belief system collapsed in front of his own cognizance. Then he'd reset.
I must have misheard. I thought she, am I incorrect that she said that he had been atheist and then when his mom passed, he saw this spirit rise up? I think that that's wonderful. The thing is when we are resisting something that is a higher truth, a larger truth, sometimes it'll be just like air filling a balloon too much. It'll fill up and then it will pop. And something very profound will happen. And I feel that that's how our guides work, our higher self, whatever we want to call it, will get us to a place with someone's mother passing. That's usually something that's really pushing the balloon anyway to make sense of it all. And we're more receptive and we're more open. And the fact that right as she left, it pushed the envelope, kind of popped, and then he was able to see it.
Well,
so
we would recommend that he watches the show above all else.
That's always
because
a good idea.
Yeah, we're very much about not being superstitious.
I tell you, I've had those incredibly, my life, just the times that I had these incredible experiences, which led me to say it was irrefutable.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like your death experience and my death experience, especially the dream one that I had. But do we have another call?
We do indeed. Hi, caller. What's your name, please?
And I just had a question for you.
Okay.
People often talk about life as an illusion. And those
yes.
things, it's all an illusion. I'm going to hang up because my TV won't mute, but I just wanted your thoughts on what exactly do you think the illusion is? Thanks. Bye-bye.
Okay. The illusion is this imprint of amnesia that we all have. You could, without a doubt, recognize every other human being on this planet as an old friend, were it not for the illusion. The illusion drives evolution, so to speak. In other words, because we are so absent-minded, we seem to be starting over again in all of these places. But they're actually, once you see the bigger picture, oh, it's hi, you again, and we're going to dance what this time? Okay, and I signed on that, right? Okay, begin. And then there is the insult heralded or whatever that might be. But the illusion is not recognizing things. We're seeing the illusion, not what's actually going on.
Well, the illusion maybe could be called the delusion.
Yeah,
because it
well
really
put.
Is in the eye of the beholder, any illusion. Because I really don't believe in my personal reality that there's anything that we can perceive that is not an illusion in that way, or everything is an illusion or nothing is an illusion. So there's not, okay, this reality is an illusion and then we're going to pop out of this and be in something that's real. I think illusion is talking more about the eyes or the glasses that we view reality. And why that's so important is that delusion makes us think that we're limited and that this is all there is. Therefore, we have to have fear and all these things. The illusion or the delusion would show us that we live on between two points on the line of infinity. And just by living in those two points on the line of infinity, we're going to have a death, a birth, an up and a down, and all that. And so getting out of that focus is a good idea, and just know that all things, wherever we are, on whatever plane of existence we are, is being driven from here. I actually went into a future life with a client that we had in a future life event that we were doing, because she was having difficulty visualizing, so I went with her, and I went into a life, and in this example of this life, and this is how I see the illusion, is there was almost like a hologram that was projected, you know, and it looked like stars, and it looked like, you know, the moon out there, but it was really a projection. And what's real is to look in here. This is the source that is projecting those planets up in this, planetariums. And, you know, we're the source of that, whether we call ourselves the God part of us or whatever. And so directing the real infinity internally, and the hologram of the infinity out this way.
There's a teacher who states that there is indeed one reality, which is, to me, suspect because of the word one, but okay, I can go with unity, and states that that one reality is the unity, that everything is love. No matter what it looks like, it's love.
Oh, I agree with that,
and
yes.
Until you can recognize absolutely everything that happens as love, you are otherwise caught in the illusion. So to get to the point, so then we seek methods, tools by which we more easily recognize love, as to get to the point where it is all recognizable as love. So we have for years been stating things like, whatever that adult is acting out, that was acted out in front of them as a child, and they therefore think that that's love. But the person's killing animals and being nasty and writing graffiti on walls and stuff like that. Well, that's what that person thinks love is. Well, that's a little different, isn't it? That is an unusual graffiti. At any rate, to actually recognize it all, and then that's the shortcut, so to speak. If you could suddenly put on glasses that allowed you to yes, rose-colored glasses, they're available at the dollar store. And then you actually do recognize everything as an act of love, then you'd be undefeatable.
Well, I had written something a number of years ago, probably about 8 years ago, I don't know if you recall it consciously or not, about how everything is love. And uh-huh. I don't know, maybe this is even what you're referring to, and that anything that we view is not love, like sadness or anger or whatever, is just love missing a component.
Yeah, I remember that
writing. I used to think that when I was in a state of like somebody rejecting me or something like that, it was like, okay, they have the love over there and I've been pushed away from love. How mm-hmm. can I find my way back to love? And it is true that when you're living under the assumption, and that's what I was saying about getting back to seeing that the universe is within you, or you could say love is within you, and that if we are seeing things that don't feel like love, like somebody hurting somebody mm-hmm. or any of this, that it's just love acting out with a component missing, and the component missing is all coming from inside the house. And so there's some part of us that is not perceiving the totality of that love, and when we do, you know, it becomes very apparent to us. And overall, there are times, honestly, where I would wake up in the morning just sick to my stomach, thinking about all the children and the elderly people and all the animals and all the people going to school that, you know, might be confronting a bully and all this, and then I realize.
Yeah, well, as long as there's love and not love, it is still the illusion. That is, in fact, a definition of the illusion, the duality, love and non-love.
Well,
the recognition that there is only love, and when you recognize everything as love, was mentioned by Drunvalo. I do recall the very brilliant writings that you were from years ago. When you were channeling that stuff, I really do recall all that. I was just saying that that is the definition that we're talking about, is the illusion is love or not love.
That's what.
And the truth, or the bigger picture, or the rest of that, is that it really is just love. There are no victims. We all have free will. We have always chosen, we've all chosen every bit of this.
Well, like I was, just to finish up that thing about the,
yes.
When I would wake up and I would see that, and what was very helpful to me with that that kind of concept is I used to believe I could be separate from love. Mm-hmm. And if you look at the world from the belief that you cannot be separate from love, it has a whole different feel to
yes.
it. Mm-hmm. And so I was not helping anybody in the world by perpetuating this fear of
yeah.
being separate from love.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And so love mixed with fear, love with the illusion of separateness makes us feel fearful, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Put that, put more information in there and the unity of love appears.
Yeah, and that's all it really is. That's the mm-hmm. higher consciousness. Wisdom is knowledge applied mm-hmm. and wisdom is there's knowledge, wisdom, and evolution. Wisdom has, it's like a molecule. Wisdom is connected to knowledge and wisdom is connected to evolution. It's sort of the go-between. So if you have just knowledge, nothing much is happening. Once you apply the knowledge, you have wisdom. Once the knowledge has been applied, you have evolution. And that's the process mm-hmm. that's going on
here.
I
agree with that.
So then this is just another set of words to comprehend our reality. If everything is recognized as love, well then your job here would be pretty much complete.
Well, you see,
then it would be about getting other people to pay attention to it.
I think that's part of the illusion, is that we have to be here and it's not our choice any longer,
mm-hmm.
that we came here because we have to learn these things. I mean, this
well,
concept
have
of have
talking,
to
yes.
being here
mm-hmm.
and that we're imprisoned and somehow we're going to get enough things that, enough, you know, poker chips that we can graduate from this place. I think that you have to love it away, anything. You
oh,
have
absolutely.
To be able to accept it. I think a long time ago I was saying that we have to get to the place where we love it here.
Yeah, and the third dimension is an exercise in borders, and until you
That's
love
what I
borders.
Said, yeah.
Yeah, I'm quoting mm-hmm. that what you were saying, so that loving the restrictions we create here is the method by which,
yeah.
so it all turns out to be love, and that is as far as I know. Now then the question becomes, well, all right, fine, where do we go from here? Which is dealt with in future lives, and I'm sure you have methods of talking about what happens after we have graduated from the into the as it's called, but into the next step beyond incarnation.
Mm-hmm.
And what is that?
Well, now
which
we can,
curious.
You know, when you get out of the have-tos, you know, like
yeah.
when you're a short-timer at work, you know, where you just go in because you quit and you've only got 2 more weeks, you know how everything just takes on a different feel because you're not
that
in prison.
It is a prison term.
We
know.
Really have to get out of seeing things as prison and look, find
yeah.
your choice in all things. But I
yeah,
believe
yeah.
that we are being called to that time of the day.
Yes. All right. Time for the duck.
Have compassion. Whoops.
All right. Later on, we'll have something else.
We'll leave compassion here on the floor for the evening.
And openness.
Okay.
Thank you, which is opposite
All
of
right.
closedness, especially if you're looking for a pizza at 3 a.m. But openness is the idea of. Well, it is kind of self-explanatory, that you're not exclusive of things, that you're saying this way and no other way.
I was just looking at this compassion, and I was seeing it as compassion. It's like calling your passion.
Yeah. That's a useful one. A passion without reason is obsession. People who become obsessed have lost their reason. It's a very interesting way to look at things.
Well, it really does have to be a balance between the head and the heart.
Yeah.
I wrote something tonight. It just occurred to me that being in the mind too much is the same thing as being in the mind not enough.
Mm-hmm.
It's really got to be a balance point between
Absolutely.
The two.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Indeed. Well, I'll take a few minutes before we get a call. Can I have the Mayan thing?
Sure.
I'll just go ahead and announce class. Neville is going to be doing the Galactic History this Saturday from 4 to 6:30.
Yes.
And on the 24th, we're doing Consciously Creating Your Life. On March 1st, I'm going to be doing Weight Loss for Hypnosis as a group event. It's going to be really good. We're going to be able to get back to some self-discovery things, mm-hmm. and followed by the Ascension Merkaba that Neville will be doing, and then bowls later that evening. And then on the 3rd, I'm starting part 3 of the Psychic Development Series, and you do not have to have taken part 1 and part 2 to join in. We're going to be doing psychometry and mediumship, and I'm developing a whole website devoted to this so that we can do research and study together. But it's really a fun time, 4 Monday nights. And then on the 8th is face reading and the fire ceremony. And then on the 9th is EFT, Overcoming Stress and Anxiety. I'll be doing that. Mm-hmm. And Neville's got a new workshop he's doing called the 13th Step. And then on the 22nd, opening of the third eye ceremony that's expanded. Mm-hmm. We never seem to find the right amount of time in that, so we have made it longer. Sekim, and
that'll
then on
work.
The 29th, Vibrational Healing. And that would do us for March.
Mm-hmm.
And then we still have our Serpent Mound trip coming up the 4th through 7th of April, and there's still room if you want to come and do a road trip. It's going to be a lot of fun. We're going to have a ghost hunt, or not a ghost hunt, a ghost tour of old Portsmouth, Ohio, and then we're going to go to the mound, and we're going to do a new moon ceremony at the mound, and a past life event, and seeing the murals. It's lots of fun.
All kinds of things.
Okay?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, the just one point before the calls begin.
Mm-hmm.
The difference between the head and heart, which has been studied for a long time by a lot of people, and I would sum it up by saying
one's
the difference between the head and the heart is that the heart has not yet begun to doubt. The heart is what knows. The head is what doubts.
Mm-hmm.
And the argument between your knowing and your doubting is the illusion, is the duality. And the not doubting is the unity. So, let's begin with our calls. Hi, caller, what's your name, please?
Hi, my name is Kate.
Kate, what can we do for you?
Could I please get a reading? Thank you
okay.
so much.
Sure.
Thank you. All right, let's see what we get this time. The stress card, if you look at that, that person is like standing on a ball or like a bubble and juggling and doing all these things, and a monkey standing there getting ready to puncture that. And what's so ironic about this is this person would be a lot happier just standing on the ground and setting some of that stuff down, yet the whole time he's doing it, he's worried about getting the very thing that he's looking to do. So stress really doesn't get you anywhere. And so this is calling for setting down some of those old roles and saying, hey, what do I have in my life that's really me, and what is it that belongs to other people? And these people are communicating, but not really. The real self isn't there. They're filled with projections on how they feel about themselves and worries about what that other person is expecting, and nothing really clear gets communicated. So if there's somebody in your life that you've really wanted to have a real heart-to-heart conversation with, I would say this is telling you to go ahead and do that. Open up and just reveal who you really are. Life is much easier that way, too. Thanks, Kate.
Mm-hmm. Hey, we have our next caller. Hi, caller. What's your name, please?
Hi, this is Merced again, and I wanted to thank you for your comments regarding illusion. I thought that was great. And I just wanted to ask for a general reading from Mary.
Okay. Thank you very much. And I appreciate the hanging up, too, when there's that
mm-hmm.
feedback. That's
mm-hmm.
really great. That way you can hear a little better. The first card we get is the ripeness. This card can speak of this is a good time to act, and I really feel that it is, like you're coming to some great synchronicity right now with your life. But I have always seen this card, too, to represent teaching and learning. So I feel like there has been a lot of growth and learning going on. And the totality, to me, this feels like, you know, when our head and our heart are in resonance, or our head and our body, you know, we can do a lot of things here in the material plane, but we feel lost spiritually. And when we're connected with spirit, we feel, I want to get up and drive around that beltway every day. This is just saying those three aspects of you are really coming into play right now. And you're addressing something, some issue in your life on all three levels, which is wonderful. And this is talking about the change that's coming as a result of those. So learning new things, learning more about yourself and how to see things from seeing things multidimensionally will bring about change. Oh, thank you.
Exciting, yeah. Mm-hmm. And do we have a... Okay. All right, so our program this evening is on this subject of what is standing in your way. Mm-hmm. And primarily what's standing in our way is not what we see. The beginning of getting rid of it is to first be able to identify it. So as in the dreaming technique, if you will ask yourself to, at this very moment, present yourself to me, what is standing in my way? Okay. And then whatever image has appeared in front of you, and be honest, it's okay, because an image did appear. It appeared right before you said, well, I didn't see anything. Whatever that image is, it's highly translatable. And what we would love to do on this program is to assist you to get past whatever it is that's standing in your way. So if someone would like to call in with whatever image they saw right in front of them a moment ago, we would be more than happy to translate it for you, as it will be a valid dream symbol, as it will be, there's a word that's not in English, not much on the planet, but your ability to communicate with yourself through symbols, soul, fine, okay, will allow, well, that worked rapidly. Hi, caller, what's your name, please?
Hi, my name's Virginia.
Virginia, okay.
What can I do
up?
For you?
Hello?
Oh,
I'd like to ask Mary for a
Okay. That's a cell phone, I'm going to bet.
Well, yeah, I think there's a lot of forces and energies that go into the phone connection here working okay.
Yeah, they're busy. We've got gnomes on that. They had a union meeting, and they're gun gnomes. That gnomes thing is out. Mm-hmm. They're gun gnomes.
Yeah, they didn't want, you know, the G is now speaking up. It used to be silent.
Yes.
Okay. The clinging to the past card is the first card that comes up. And if you look at this, it's a person carrying around things from the past, and they're missing this beautiful cup of light that's right there. This is talking about, you know, you've done a lot of work. I really do feel that you have done a lot of work to take things out of having an impact on you, things that you may have gone through when you're younger. And what happens when you release the past is, boy, you're a lot lighter. It's like throwing sandbags out of a hot air balloon. All of a sudden, you just feel like, hey, I can move forward. And like this child that had been kind of paralyzed in the dark, wondering if it was safe to step forward, and he did. And as soon as he did, the light came on, and he began adventure. And as a matter of fact, the times that are the most adventurous, that we look back as being, ooh, really, really fun, was when we took a risk, when we, you know, took that step. And this compromise, one thing I feel about you is that everything is fine when you're by yourself. It's like you can really get to see how you create your reality and everything. But when you have to start operating with other people, it can like, you find yourself having to compromise who you are. This is where I feel getting in touch with your adventurer and letting your adventurer go with you, even when you're entering into agreements with other people, and just not settle and say everybody can win. I don't have to give up something that everybody can indeed win.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, everyone has indeed a material telepathy, a telepathy that's based on being a material being. And since we are also spirit beings, we'll continue this. Hi, caller, what's your name, please?
My name's Linda.
Good choice. What
Hi,
can we
Linda.
Do for you?
Hi, I'd like a reading from Mary, please.
Okay. Did you want to finish what you were saying before I start?
No, I'll wait till afterwards. I was seeing if we could get someone to actually visualize block that we could translate.
Well, I'm sure there's many people that are doing that. Mm-hmm. Okay, the first card we get is patience, and it shows a woman that's getting ready to give birth. And one thing that this says is that there is a lot of creative endeavors within you. Almost like, I feel like there's a lot around your head too. I don't know if you kind of come up with ideas and write them down or whatever, but I just feel like there's a lot of creative ideas. And one thing I'm getting with this is just to like focus on a couple of them and see them into getting them birthed into physical reality, because I think that you would just feel a lot better about things. And remember, patience isn't waiting. Waiting implies that it may not happen. Patience knows that it will. And I would say to look at it that way. And the miser, this lady is just, she has all of her treasures around her and she doesn't feel safe to sit them down anywhere. And you have a lot of gifts. And I feel you're very creative, artistic. And I don't know if you even sing, but I'm feeling something like even musically with you, and that maybe part of you has been afraid of it being rejected and haven't really pulled it to the surface. And as you start getting the part of you that would judge you in balance with the part of you that is afraid of being judged, so that they kind of cancel each other out, this integration, that's when I feel things are going to really start coming forward for you. So, lots of creativity there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So again, our program is on the subject of getting past what is laughingly referred to as blocks in life. We've been listing all this time techniques of recognizing and dissolving blocks, and we've outlined two or three that I can think of, probably more like a dozen methods that may be totally new, totally refreshing to anybody watching. To recognize and alleviate this process of stumbling blocks that appear to be on our path. And in a reality's light, there is no such thing as any of the above. No stumbling and no blocks, simply path.
Well, I would really suggest, first of all, that last caller, I feel someone named Marshall was coming in, and it may be a guide or somebody that's in spirit that wanted to contact you. It's just very, very loud.
The last caller.
Yes, the last caller. It just felt really good energies, and I know we don't usually get into
this is fine.
Loved ones, although we'll do a show on that one night and let people call in for messages from people on the other side, because we have not done that, I think, in a long time, if ever, have we done a show with that.
Not that specific concept.
So we'll do that.
Sure.
People can call in for messages. But do that exercise where just list out the things in your life where you feel held back, restricted. It's actually, I'm very logical as well as intuitive, and it's very mathematical. It's an equation. Where do I feel blocked? What are the blocks? And how can I translate those blocks into fears that are keeping me from getting to there? And if you could translate them into fears and release them, the blocks really do disappear.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It turns out that our ultimate fear as humans is change.
Mm-hmm.
And that is because of the superstitious notion that somehow the universe would travel backwards at the moment that I was changing and the whole thing would be against me, which is superstitious stuff, nonsense, trash. Have it removed. Put it out with the rest of the garbage. It's simply not true. We evolve. That is what we do. There is no experience you have ever had that has not been on your side, that has not been assisting you in your evolution. There is no experience you have ever had that you have not chosen. And being aware of this, okay, therefore change is very much on our side. We at the same time champion change because of the implied freedom. If I were to change, who would I become? And then whatever that might be that you would choose to become is a very exciting idea. Mm-hmm. Who would you choose to become? There's a whole show right there.
Me.
Yeah. And what would, and then a further definition, what would the you in 10 years be doing that you don't see now? And then there's the creation of the flight path, because we all do have the flight path, mm-hmm. and it has already been pretty well decided, even though we are here in the timeline. There is still
we have a
the
call.
Future.
We have time for another call?
Sure, I believe we do. Hi, caller. What's your name, please?
It's Jim.
Jim.
Hey, Jim.
Hey, what can we do for you?
Just want to get a reading.
Okay. Be happy to. Thanks for calling.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, I'm feeling like I'm just getting a lot of other side communication tonight. Let's focus on this. Okay, the first card we get, the breakthrough, I feel like there are some things that you've gone through in your life that were, that really gotcha, you know, in that dark night of the soul where you sit there and say, okay, I got to really make a fundamental decision about whether I'm going to let this get to me or if I'm going to break out of it. And the thing about the breakthrough card is some people have breakdowns and some people turn those into breakthroughs. And as a result of that, if you look at this creativity, and I've said this many times on the show, but I had a dream about this card, and in it God said you can throw away all the others because everything comes through this doorway of creativity.
Mm-hmm.
And this is talking about right now, there's a lot of creative flow going on in your life, and just see how it is you would like to ride that current. And it's, we open up to creativity, and the how the creativity manifests will show up. It's really not the other way around. And one thing here, people that are very intuitive, which I feel you are, often don't have a way to have boundaries, because it can be very stimulating, I would say, to constantly be knowing what's going on with everybody and picking up that psychic river going through us. And so they tend to freeze up. And now's the time to go ahead and let that passion of what you love to do to melt away the ice that you might have been encased in the last little while. And it's just going to be lovely. Sometimes mm-hmm. we just have to cry those rainbow tears of passion so that the ice
Sounds
that
good.
We were programmed with just drips away.
Mm-hmm. Rainbow Tribe, mm-hmm. Rainbow Coalition, mm-hmm. there's a lot of rainbows going on around here. Very important concept mm-hmm. all the way around. And did we have a second caller, I thought, perhaps? Hi, caller, what's your name, please?
Hi, it's Tricia.
Tricia.
Hi, good to hear from you.
Thank you. I wanted to share one way that I feel that I've dissolved blocks is with say team.
Whoa,
yeah.
Amazing faculty, isn't it?
It's awesome because it's changing for mm-hmm. me. It's got me, and I'm starting to see all kinds of Egyptian symbols again like I did when
Excellent.
I first was called to it.
Excellent.
So it's kind of changing to doing more meditations and calling people together. And like I did a meditation last night on a situation that I wanted guidance with, and a snake came in, and I felt like,
ooh.
Good guidance.
That's very
yeah,
good.
Yeah, that's the transmutation is occurring. By the way, there was the lunar eclipse last night here on the east coast of the United States from about 9:30
to
10.
Started at 8:43 and went to 10:51.
Yeah,
full.
Yeah. And your meditation may very well have been during that eclipse, which is a very interesting concept. Eclipse is, we human beings are used to having light bouncing off of us. And then when something like an eclipse happens, we kind of like all do Scooby-Doo all at once and go, huh? So in that moment, there's an opening that we're not used to.
I'm getting Neville some Scooby-Doo underoos.
Yeah, well, good, okay. I'll wear them proudly.
Do they still make underoos?
I'm yeah. certain that they do.
Well, thank you, Tricia. That's wonderful. And you know, you are exactly right that Sekim is a brilliant way of doing that.
Yes.
It's not just removing blocks in the physical body. It can be in the emotional body. It can uh-huh. be in the mental body, too.
Yeah.
Yeah,
the
very
physical
good.
Behaviors are rooted in the mental, emotional behaviors, which are rooted in the spirit behaviors. So the analysis of all that, and then ultimately, the evolution means changing the spirit. Mm-hmm. Or let us say, aggrandizing, amplifying, making better the spirit. That's the point of evolution, to become a more evolved spirit. So
yeah,
that chain of command.
Yeah, to me, the evolution, what that really means is becoming more aware of myself, and
mm-hmm.
myself is everyone. So
yes.
that to me is
very
evolution
well
and growth.
Yeah, very well put.
And I would also like to just take this moment to say that the main principle of our show is to share with people how to think, not what to think.
Yeah, very well put.
And it's really everyone's sacred, loving mission is to think for yourself and do things that are right for you because they're right for you. You know, I can't tell anybody what to do. I can only share my view of that.
And to mention John and Paul, I am you as you are me and we are all together.
Mm-hmm.
And you can
and I
see
commit
how
to understanding me more, therefore
yeah.
the whole universe.
You can see how that John Lennon chose the choices he chose, you know, based on being the person that came up with that particular rhyme. I believe that's John Lennon's. If it was Paul's, pardon me, Paul, but nonetheless, I do feel that was the place at which a certain frequency of awareness occurred that would have allowed for the subsequent events and the decisions made. Not that we're here to particularly philosophize, but welcome to your life.
Yeah, and if you guys have been thinking of doing that serpent mound, contact me because it'll be a lot of fun. Mm-hmm. I'm really excited about that.
Right, and we have all kinds of shows archived. Mm-hmm. And what else do we say? It's just beautiful. If there's someone you wish to admonish or that you have feelings of
you can also
detest for them, by all means, mail them our link. That'll
you can
fix
get us
good.
On iTunes. Just do a search on Telepathic TV.
Uh-huh.
And it was our joy and honor to take you to the door.
Yes, and it is your choice to go through, and you're gonna. It's a matter of when. Mm-hmm. It may as well be now, because as soon as you get through the door, it just begins.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and we love you guys.
And we love us, too.
Well, Neville's in charge of that. And
I am indeed. And as
I
always
I would say
I love the smell of my own armpits.
Oh, yeah, that's always a lovely thing to end the show with.